Hello everyone. So I'll be talking about Hadoop and Spark auto tuning. So basically this is a framework developed at LinkedIn, and it's an open source framework, and it's part of Dr. Elephant. So this framework basically automatically tunes Hadoop and Spark jobs. By tuning I mean only configuration tuning. So configuration like map reduce dot map dot memory or reduce dot memory, executor dot memory for Spark job, executor dot core for Spark jobs. So these kind of configurations are tuned by auto tuning framework, and it is automatically doing it. As he said, I am part of LinkedIn for last 3.5 years. So this is LinkedIn's vision: create economic opportunity for every member of the global workforce. And this is the mission statement, like connect the world's professional to make them more productive and successful. So this is the agenda for today's talk. I'll start with why tuning is required. So by tuning, I mean the auto tuning framework, how the framework works. There are two different kind of tuning that we do. One is heuristic based tuning and another is optimization based tuning. I'll go into details of both the tuning type. Then I'll cover the architecture, how the tuning framework interacts with other components of the Hadoop ecosystem, and we'll also provide details into the features of the framework. And finally, we'll cover what are the different items that we are working in future. So any idea how many nodes LinkedIn would have? How many cluster nodes LinkedIn would have? Any guesses? I say anyone else? So it's around 10,000 nodes. We have 10 plus clusters, thousands of nodes in each, thousands of active users who are using the Hadoop clusters. We are using different framework like Pig, Hive, Spark, TensorFlow, and there are 10,000 of workflows which are running on these Hadoop clusters. So this is the scale we deal at LinkedIn. So before going into details of tuning framework, let's look into the typical conversations that happens at LinkedIn's data team, or it might happen at your company as well. So you would have heard about, like, your manager comes to you and say that, hey, this Spark job is running very slow and it is not meeting the SLA. Can you tune this? So what does the developer do? He goes and try to change the code, maybe optimize the workflow, or try to reduce the data input. And finally, he might try to change the configuration of the job. So configuration means that he can change the split size so that there are more mappers or number of partitions and reducers, so that there are more partitions and more reducers so that the job runs fast. So these are the configuration we usually change to make the job fast. Another conversation that you might have heard about, like admin, Hadoop admin comes to you and say that your job is taking too much of resources on the cluster. Can you tune it and make sure that it doesn't basically take so much of resources? Again, same thing, you will try to basically change the workflow or optimize the workflow. If you have any duplicate tasks that you are doing, you would try to remove it. Or maybe another thing is changing the configuration of the job. You would try to maybe reduce the map memory, or maybe executor memory for the Spark job. There are some other configurations, like you can maybe try to increase the sort buffer or reduce the sort buffer. Based on that, basically you try to improve the resource uses for the job. So these conversations are very common. It would happen at any company, at any data team. And this makes sure that tuning is the basically integral part of any data team. So this says that why tuning is required, because you know that default configuration, whatever the cluster default configuration, are not always optimal for all kind of jobs. You would have different jobs running on your system. Like there might be few Spark jobs which would require high executor memory, but other Spark job might not require high executor memory. So if you tune the job or if you provide different configuration for different job, there is a better chance that you would have better cluster utilizations. And it might result in the basically reducing the execution time as well. So we are, like, we know that tuning is required. Now we'll go into different methods of tuning, what people use to tune the job. One is a very simple method with most of the companies use, like manually tuning the job. So this is a three-step iterative process where usually developers start with executing the job, then he tries to observe the execution as well. So by observing, I mean that he would look into each and every task and see which tasks are taking, which tasks are running longer. Or if a MapReduce job, for a MapReduce job, he might look into if the reducers are starting earlier and then waiting for the map data, map jobs to, map tasks to finish. So these kinds of observation he makes. And when the job finishes, he would look into the different matrices that are provided by job history server. He would look into those matrices as well, like he might look into average task time of the job and see if average task time is very low, then he might go and increase the shuffle partitions. Or if he looks into the ratio of spilled records and map output record, so that means that you have a high map output and you want to increase the sort buffer size so that there is more memory usage rather than using the disk. And if you look into the waiting reducers, you might want to increase the slow start.completed map property so that the reducers are spawned only after few map tasks are completed. So this basically manual tuning is time consuming because you have to at least run a job for 3-4 times or 5-6 times to come up with the optimal parameter. It requires expertise. By expertise, I mean that you have to know about the system, what Hadoop system is, where do you get the job history server data, what are the different matrices, what are the different parameters that you want to tune, what are the dependencies between these parameters, how it impacts the next executions. You have to have those expertise if you are doing the manual tuning. And when you are doing the manual tuning, you have to do it with the full data set. If you do it with the sample data set, then whatever parameter that you find might not run with the full data set. So it requires resources to do those 5 or 6 runs to get the optimal parameter. There is another way of tuning Dr. Elephant. Dr. Elephant is a open source tool developed at LinkedIn, which is a monitoring and tuning tool. So this is basically, it provides some kind of predefined heuristics and give you tuning recommendations. So this predefined heuristic might be like looking at a Spark job, it finds out that your peak JVM usage is lower than your executor memory. Let's say you are giving 10 GB of memory and your peak JVM usage is only 2 GB. So it would recommend you to decrease the executor memory. Or something like if your mapper time is very low, like you're spawning a MapReduce job and mappers are finishing within 2 seconds. So it's a overhead on cluster. Basically, you have to spawn those many tasks. It would basically recommend you to increase the split size. So these kinds of recommendations are given by Dr. Elephant. Here, user does not need to worry about the counters and the parameter. They can just look into the Dr. Elephant report, and based on that, it can come up with the next set of parameter. Again, this is also an iterative process where user has to go and execute the job and basically find out the parameter. There is some kind of expertise also needed. Basically, you have to find out how those parameters affect the execution. So this is a screenshot of one of the applications for a Spark job. So these are 9 different heuristics which is provided. There are few which are only informatic, like Spark configuration, which provides you what is the configuration that you have used for the applications. Then Spark job metrics and Spark stage metrics only suggest like how many jobs were run on this application and how many stages were there, how many of them were passed, how many of them were failed. There are few interesting, this is executor peak unified memory, which says you how much of unified memory was used by the application. So if you have allocated, let's say, 5 GB of memory for unified area, so it would, and you are using only 1 GB of that, it would basically suggest you to decrease the unified memory. The next of that is executor JVM use memory. This basically is the for whole task, what is the JVM memory used by the executor. And this also says you, if you have given executor memory as 10 GB, and you are using only 2 GB, it will give you the recommendation to decrease the memory. There are a few more heuristics. One is executor GC, executor spill, which tells you about how much of time your application is consuming GC, and how much of spill is happening. There are some driver metrics also, which basically looks into application driver. So these are some of the heuristics that is provided for Spark, and it gives you suggestions like that executor JVM used memory. This is a heuristic for peak JVM used memory. It is saying that your max peak JVM used memory is maybe lesser than your executor memory. You should basically decrease your executor memory. So we have already talked about why tuning is needed, and we have also talked about two different methods. One is manual tuning, and another is the Dr. Elephant tuning. We will go into why auto tuning is required, because at LinkedIn we have around 10,000 of jobs to tune. We have different kind of user, like there are developers who has expertise on Hadoop ecosystem, but we have business users as well who are firing Hadoop queries as well. So those guys doesn't know about how to tune their jobs. So if there are like 10,000 of jobs to tune, manually tuning that would be a lot of overhead. It also increases developer productivity, because developer doesn't have to now go and tune their job. They can just rely on auto-tuning framework. It doesn't require any kind of extra effort. No expertise is expected from user, because user doesn't have to do anything. They can just go and enable the job for auto-tuning, and the job will be tuned automatically. And there are few options provided for objective functions, so you can tune it for resource uses, like if you want to improve the resource uses of the job, you can do it for that, or you can also try execution time as well. So I already covered like manual tuning and Dr. Elephant, and we have already discussed why auto tuning is required. We'll now go into details of how auto tuning framework works, what are the different methods that we are using for tuning the job. So this framework is a framework to automatically tune recurring Hadoop and Spark jobs. By recurring, I mean that scheduled jobs on production cluster. You can also tune non-scheduled jobs as well, but you have to run those jobs multiple times. And it iteratively tries to reach the optimal configuration. What it does is basically it suggests different parameter for each execution. So, and it automatically tries those parameters as well and analyze those execution, and based on that it will come up with the next set of parameters as well. So it's a three different processes that are running. One is recurring job, which is basically executing, let's say, daily, which may be executed by any kind of scheduler or workflow orchestration tool like Azkaban, Uzi, or Airflow. What it does is, before running the job, it will ask from tuning framework what is the configuration that I should use. So tuning framework will respond with the configurations. So the configuration can be, let's say, you should use map.memory as 4 GB, reduce.memory as 2 GB, sort.buffer as maybe 500 MB. So these kinds of configurations are suggested, and then the executor basically runs the job with those parameters. Once the job is run, Dr. Elephant will analyze that job, will basically find out all the predefined heuristics, will put the data into MySQL server, and then the tuning framework will consume that data and come up with the next suggestions. This process goes on until the job is properly tuned or a max number of executions are already performed. And in practice, we have seen around 20 to 35% reduction in the resource usage. We have tried it on Pig as well as on Spark job as well. So these are two different auto tuning algorithms that we are using. One is called heuristic based tuning. This basically tunes the Dr. Elephant heuristics. As I said, there are like different kind of heuristics that is provided. Like these are different heuristics for Spark jobs. And at LinkedIn, user has to make sure that all heuristics are green before the flow is promoted to production. So these heuristics has to be green before the flow is promoted to production. So what this heuristic-based tuning does is basically it tunes the Dr. Elephant heuristics into green. It suggests specific parameter values based on historical executions. And this results in improving the developer productivity because now developer doesn't have to basically tune their jobs and make the Dr. Elephant heuristic green. And it also results in improving the resource usage as well. There's another algorithm called optimization-based tuning. So this basically tunes jobs for the cost function. It can tune it for resource utilizations or execution time. It uses an algorithm called particle swarm optimization algorithm. So I'll go into details of both these methods. First, I'll start with heuristic-based tuning. So heuristic-based tuning is basically it looks into the previous execution and come up with the specific suggestions for the next run. So let's say we have started an application, which is something like this, looking into Dr. Elephant. It is showing that there are two heuristics which are red and one heuristic which is yellow and all other heuristics are green. So, and it is showing that it is consuming around 0.58 GB hours. So GB hours is the resource usage, which is computed using how much memory you are using for how much time, basically. And it is also saying that there is a wastage of around 34.48%. So now, what the algorithm will do is it will look into these heuristics. Based on those heuristics, it will come up with the parameter for next run. So we have run the algorithm, and now it is saying that this is the configuration that you should use for the next run. So earlier, let's say we have started with 4 GB executor memory and one core. Now it is suggesting us to use 9,300 MB of executor memory and 929 MB of driver memory, executor core S4. So system will automatically run the job, run the next execution with these parameters. And this is the heuristics that is shown in the next run. Now you have seen that out of 8, 7 are green and 1 is still red, which is executor JVM use memory, which says that you are giving more executor memory. So system comes up with a new parameter set, which is 4.6 GB of executor memory. Driver memory would remain same, and it has also increased the executor core. So we have given some maximum limit on executor cores at which can be for our system we are using 3, but it is a configurable parameter. You can give 4, 5, whatever it is required for your cluster. And it is also saying you to use memory fraction as 0.05 because it has noticed that you are using very less unified memory. Again, the system runs the job with this parameter and it finds out still the executor JVM use memory is red. And it reduces the executor memory further and makes it 2 GB, around 1.8 GB. And finally, all the heuristics are green. So these are the four runs that we did. If you see, the last run is this is the first run. It is consuming around 0.586 GB hours, and one of the job is critical. There were two runs which were having two jobs as severe, and finally the last run has one job as low, which is saying that there is no heuristic which is red, and it is consuming around 0.236 GB hours, which is pretty less than what it was consuming in the first run. So this is what heuristic-based tuning is. We'll go into optimization-based tuning. So this optimization-based tuning is basically it uses particle swarm optimization algorithm in the behind. So as we noticed, there are three components. One is the executor, which executes the job. Then Dr. Elephant, which analyzes the job. And the third component is basically tuning framework, which comes up with the parameters. So with HPD, we were looking into the last execution and coming up with the parameter for that. With PSO, with optimization-based tuning, PSO is the algorithm which basically comes up with the parameter for next run. What it does is basically it mimics the behavior of swarm of birds searching food. So I'll give you a feel of this algorithm. What it does is basically, let's say swarm of birds is searching for food, and food is located right here. And this is the search space it is searching in. So what this algorithm starts with, it will start with three random locations. Let's say it puts the swarm on these three corners and will start looking into finding the position of the food. So what it does is each swarm can find out the distance between his and to the food particles, and it can also communicate between what is the distance for all the swarms. And based on that, it will find out the next set of parameter which it has to use. In case of swarm, it will basically decide the next locations for all three swarms. So you start the optimization by introducing particle at the random position. And so look at this GIF, which basically is showing how your how the particle swarm optimization is converging into a space. So this color gradient shows cost function value. If you see this bar at the right side, which shows what is the cost function value for each color. So violet is the color which is having the least value, and all particles are converging into the violet color. So here, points of attraction is basically personal and global best known position. So each swarm will look into what is the personal best position for that, and it will also look into global best known position, and based on that, it will come up with the next set of parameters. And particle is converging into the region with the minimal cost functions. So why we are using PSO is because here the cost function is noisy. If you try to run the same job with the same input data at different time, you would find that the runs are very different. You might have resources as 100 GB hours in the first run, and in the second run you might have resources as 120 GB hours. So it is a very noisy function. But PSO is a gradient-free, and it's robust against noise. That's why we are using PSO. And you know that Spark and Hadoop systems are very complex system. To basically come up with a function is very difficult. So this PSO is a meta-heuristic black box optimization algorithm. You don't need to come up with the function. And we have seen in practice that it converts fastest. We have seen within 20 execution, we were able to find the optimum value of the parameter. So details of the PSO, what should be the swarm size? So by swarm size, I mean how many swarms you need to put to find the food grains. So we have seen that 3 gives the best result for us. Why? Because it is not too small to cover the subspace. If you put 1, then it will take a lot of time to cover the subspace. And it is not too big to do many first iteration random searches. If you keep it like 10, then you would have to do 10 random searches. Otherwise, you are doing only 3 random runs. So good starting point is very important to guide the swarm, because that's the how it will basically guide towards the optimal location. So what was the cost function for us? Cost function for resource uses per unit of input. So how we calculate resources is basically summation of container memory into container uptime. So if you have like 2 container and each is of 4 GB and it is running for 1 hour, then your resource usage would be 4 into 1 plus 4 into 1, which would be 8 GB hours. And it is divided by total input size. So why we want to divide it by total input size? Because we wanted to keep it input size invariant, because we know that in production there might be days where you have input size as 100 GB and another day it might be maybe 50 GB. So we wanted to keep it input size invariant. It should not depend on input size. What is your search space? So in this case, our search space is all parameter. If you see, if there are 3 parameter, it would be a 3-dimensional search space. That parameter being tuned considers the search space. And the parameters depends on the cost function. If you want to keep the resource usage as cost function, your parameter might be different. Or for execution time, it would be different. So these are the parameters that we use for our experiment. For pig, we have used map.memory.mb, reduce.memory.mb, sort.mb, and sort.factor. For Spark, we have used executor memory, executor cores, and memory fraction, as well as memory overhead. So these are the parameters that we have used for tuning our jobs. Search space reduction, because we know that parameters can be anything. Like, you have to bound those parameters by some boundary value so that your search space is very less. Otherwise, it would be very difficult to converge. And it can also result into failures as well. So if you don't restrict your search space, maybe let's say for a parameter called map.memory.mb, if you keep memory very low, your job may fail. So you want to reduce the search space. It also speeds up the convergence. So we are using two different kind of constraints. One is boundary parameter. For each parameter, there would be some boundary defined. Like for executor core, the boundary is, let's say, 1 to 10. And there are parameter independent constraints. So it captures the independence among the parameters. So let's say you know that if your sort buffer is more than 60% of your memory, then there is high chances that job will fail. So we keep these kinds of constraints so that your parameter should not be in this range. And these constraints are derived dynamically. Basically, all your jobs might have different constraints. Some job will require high memory, some job will require low memory, or maybe you know that one of the job will have high map output, so you want to define different constraints for those. So we have dynamic constraints, which basically defines these kinds of boundary value as well as interdependence among the constraints. So if you are basically optimizing for resource usage and you are trying to reduce the memory, it may happen that you have reduced the memory so much that your execution time shoots up. To avoid those cases, what we do is we have changed the cost function to include the penalty. So if there is any execution which results into increasing the execution time maybe by 150%, we would introduce penalty for that parameter so that the algorithm does not recommend those kinds of parameter in future. Convergence, there is no theoretical bound on the steps to converge, but in practice we have seen it takes around 20 job execution to converge. And the tuning will get disabled once the job converges to a optimal parameter. So these are the results that we have seen for Spark. There are around 30 to 40% gain in the resource usage. And for Pig, we have seen around 20 to 35% of the gain in the resource usage. So I've covered both the different type of tuning algorithm that we are using. Now I'll go into details of architecture. So basically there are three components. One is Dr. Elephant, which is basically analyzing the job and coming up with the suggestions for the parameter. There is scheduler or the workflow orchestration tool. These can be like Azkaban, Uzi, or Airflow. These are the three which is integrated in Dr. Elephant. And then the execution engine, which can be Hadoop or Spark. Okay. So Dr. Elephant has three different components. One is MapReducer Spark Fetchers. So these are the analyzer which actually analyze the job and basically computes the heuristics for each job. So what these fetches does is basically it will look into resource manager and finds out what are the application that has finished recently. And for those application, it will go into job history server or maybe application log and compute the predefined heuristics and put it into MySQL database. Then there is tuning framework, which basically consume the data from analyzer and then come up with the parameter for next run. There are REST APIs on which expose the data, and there is another REST API called get parameters. This is called get current run parameter, which basically returns the parameter that are suggested by the tuning framework. So how these are integrated is, let's say we will take an example of Azkaban job. When the Azkaban job is running, it will call, before running the job, it will call the get current run parameter API, which returns the parameter. So in this case, it can be map memory is 2 GB and sort buffer is 200 MB. And then the Azkaban will run the job with those parameter. This job will run into Hadoop and Spark. Finally, the fetchers will fetch the data from job history server, analyze the job, compute the heuristics, and then tuning framework will take over that and will come up with the parameter for next run. So this whole thing is automated. We already have Azkaban Spark job integrated with Dr. Elephant. We are working on integrating Azkaban Pig job as well. And this Dr. Elephant is already in open source. Azkaban is also an open source tool which can be used by anyone. So what are the different framework features? So, like, one of the important framework feature is basically tuning is done during regular schedule run. So we have around 10,000 of jobs which need to be tuned. We cannot basically take out extra resources and tune them like running them multiple times. We have to tune them when their regular scheduled runs is happening. So this framework makes sure that you have tuning done during regular schedule run. It makes sure that the parameter it recommends should not result in failure. It's a generic framework. You can use any cost function. Currently, we are having a support for resource usage, but in future, we are planning to use for execution time as well. It supports different kind of frameworks, like Pig, Hive, Spark, and you can include for anything as well. The integration is very easy. There is one API that a user has to integrate with. Failure avoidance, we have constraints on parameters so that there is no failure. It may happen that there is a lot of variance in the input data and which results in failure for few jobs. Those are handled by automatic failure handling. What it does is it will retry the job with the default parameters for those failures. Auto switch off, basically the tuning will switch off automatically after it converges into an optimal value. So in future, we want to work on HBT for Pig and Hive. We already have a solution for Spark job, which is heuristic-based tuning. We would be working for Pig and Hive as well in future. Azkaban integration for Hive and Pig, which is not done yet. We want to do that as well. Tuning for execution time, which is still unexplored area. We want to do that as well in future. Currently, the switch off feature is there, but there is no switch on again if there is, there is increase in resource usage because of change in the job. So in future, we would like to work on switch on as well. These are some references for our presentation. And this tool is basically open source. You can find the Dr. Elephant GitHub repository. Thank you. Any questions? So that's why we are using peak executor memory, peak unified memory, which gives you the whatever is the highest. Highest value, yes.
The tune-in framework, is it something, an UI, or it is a framework, or I didn't quite understood that particular part of it.
So this framework basically suggests the parameters. There is already a UI for Dr. Elephant, which I have shown in these slides, basically. Just a minute. So these kinds of UI is shown. So every application will have different kind of heuristics as green or red, and it shows recommendation parameter as well. So if user want to try manually, they can go and try these parameter manually as well. If they want to try automatically as well, they can just enable auto training and those parameter would be tried in the next run.
This goes through complete actual runs, or say for example, if one of my Spark jugs takes 2 hours, 3 hours, is it just run and parse the program and gets a parameter, or it actually runs?
It doesn't run the job. So it is integrated with Azkaban. So Azkaban is the scheduler that we are using at LinkedIn. So whenever the Azkaban actually runs the job, before running the job, it will call the get current run parameter API, will get the parameter, and then Azkaban will run the job. Once the job finishes, Dr. Elephant will analyze the job. Okay, so Dr. Elephant is not running the job. Job is run by any scheduler basically.
So basically during the runtime, it captures it, then it analyzes it. For the next run, it sets it if you do auto tuning.
Yes.
Okay, I got it. Thanks.
I understand that you were trying to do the memory tuning, right? The memory, the executor memory was a lot, and you were trying to reduce the memory. But then I saw that in that effort, the CPU was going up, right? 34 to 44 to 45.
Which one?
You're reducing the amount of memory. The executor.
This is
memory.
Not CPU. Basically, this is wastage.
Yeah, the wastage of the CPU was going up.
Wastage right. of memory, basically. Wastage of resources in general.
So this is not CPU.
No, this is not CPU.
Okay, so by resources you mean it includes the memory as well.
But we compute the resource usage based on memory and how much time you have used memory. So if you're using
that formula you were talking
8
about.
GB container for 1 hour, then the resource usage would be 8 GB hours.
Okay, got that.
We use a tool called Unravel, which gives for both Spark and Hive on Spark. So it gives a lot more parameters, but I do not see. It gives us some parallelism, and it gives us some parameter which we never, I never seen it before. Is it something it has go through the entire list, or it is customized? We need to do some customization. That's my first question.
Number of parameters is what you're saying.
Yeah, number of parameters inside. Because during our Unravel usage, we've seen that there are some special cases. It gives us some new parameters, which we first time will come to know. And also, this tool supports Hive on Spark.
This supports Spark application. So any Spark application, it will support. It doesn't matter which framework you run for. For the parameter, we have used whatever is the parameter which creates the most impact. So for our case, like, we didn't want to optimize this too much so that there might be failures, because we were doing everything in the production run. So we wanted to keep the list of parameters very small so that it doesn't impact other things. And we wanted to take parameters which impacts the resource usage much. So memory is the only parameter which impacts the resources as much. We have taken parameter around that only. But if you want to contribute on that, like other parameters as well, happy to contribute. And for the other framework, the OBT framework, list can be defined by you. You can add any number of parameters in that. It doesn't matter. You just have to basically give the boundary conditions and come up with what kind of different constraints that you want to put for those parameters.
How many jobs does it analyze in parallel?
We have already onboarded around 1,000 jobs on this framework, but there is no limit. I mean, it is not doing much of the tool, because Dr. Elephant is already analyzing all the jobs on the cluster. So it has all the information about different metrics for each of the job. And this framework just uses that information and come up with the parameters. So there's no actual limit on how many jobs you can analyze or how many jobs you can onboard on this system.
Okay, and do we need to deploy this on a separate node or server? Because I hope it consumes some its resources or memory, right? This Dr. Elephant process.
Yes, it's a separate Java process which you need to deploy on any machine, basically.
Any machine, right?
It can be deployed on any machine.
Okay.
What?
Edge node. He's asking about Edge node.
Yes, it should be able to connect to your history server, SDFS, and RM. Okay. So it uses RM REST API and history server REST API, as well as in some cases it uses SDFS data to analyze the application logs.
Now what I'm asking, how much CPU and memory is required for this particular?
It's a simple Java process, maybe 8 GB. Okay. It's a single process itself.
All right. Thank you.
So it doesn't need to basically spawn like a MapReduce job or something like that. It's a single server process.
Okay. Thanks.
We are using around 8 GB for Dr. Elephant.
Itself or that needs to be installed separately?
Can you repeat your question? Sorry.
So based on to the API rate call, how does it store those particular parameters onto the disk or onto the
There is a MySQL behind that. Yes, so everything is stored in MySQL.
Okay, so the MySQL with this you also need a MySQL to be
Started
about.
Yes, yes. Okay. Sorry, I didn't talk about this. There would be a MySQL instance that would be needed.
So regarding this tune-in framework, the purpose of that framework is to estimate what the new parameters are to be, right? And the algorithms that you just shared, the PSPO or something
PSO.
Like that. PSO. So those are the algorithms which actually work behind the scenes,
yes.
And they will help in describing.
Coming this. Up with the parameters.
Okay, cool. Okay, thanks.
In production, which is recommended, is either HBT or PSO?
We are using both of them. For PIG, we are using PSO, and HBT is we are using for Spark jobs. But HBT is it uses the execution details completely. So there is less chances of failure in case of HBT, basically.
Okay.
And PSO basically some kind of randomization is there in coming up with the parameter, mm-hmm. So there are little more chances of failure in case of PSO.
Okay, thank you.
Let's say if I wanted to use this Dr. Elephant for another scheduling task, let's say UC4, right?
UZI.
So UC4.
Okay.
So, I mean, what is the kind of, you know, how much, you know, time it takes? You know, because, you know, I believe that, you know, it's just a REST API, right? So
there would be integration required. So what Azkaban and UZI and these workflows are doing is basically these are, for every job, they would add some kind of definition of the job, basically. So what are the job it is running? So in case of, if you go into any of the workflows, you would have some job name, some project name, or flow name.
Yeah.
So it basically inject those parameter in the configuration of the job. So when Dr. Elephant basically reads the configuration, it will find out those parameter. And based on that, it uniquely identifies what job you have run. So that kind of integration has to be done for each scheduler. Basically.
Okay, so far it is getting supported for this three?
These three scheduler.
Okay.
But in case of tuning framework, it is only provided for Azkaban currently. So nobody has taken up these UZI and Airflow. The UZI and Airflows are maintained by outside committers. We are only maintaining the Azkaban.
Okay. Thanks.
But I think as long as we are able to use the REST API and get the parameters, we should be able to use this anywhere, right?
No. The integration has to be done. Because Dr. Elephant has to uniquely identify that this is the job you have run. So let's say you are running a, I'll go to that. If you see this.
Yeah.
So auto-training test was the project name. Auto-training test flow was the job name.
Okay.
It comes from Azkaban.
Okay.
So Dr. Elephant has to uniquely identify which job it is running. So from the application ID, it cannot identify what is the job. So Azkaban, what Azkaban does is basically it inject these job name, flow name, and project name into the configuration of the job. Dr. Elephant reads that and basically identifies which job it is. And based on that, it will recommend the parameter.
So is there a tight integration between Dr. Elephant and Azkaban? Okay, cool.
So Dr. Elephant and scheduler integration is a little bit tight integration.
Okay, got it. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'm here only, so you can take it offline as well.